Hello everyone. So in the last video we were having a discussion regarding the network layer, and in this also we will continue our discussion regarding the network layer. But now in this video we will take the IP datagram and we'll see what are the components of IP header, and we'll elaborate each and every component of IP header and what is their responsibility for all those IP headers. Okay. Now, if you want to download the PDF of this PPT, the PDF of this presentation that I'm recording here is also available on our website, which is www.dgmentor.com. So you can go to the website and over there you can go to the download section and you can find the PDF copy of the same presentation and PPT that I'm recording here. Okay. So let's start our discussion, and here we will start our discussion with the network layer. So obviously till this point of time we already had a discussion regarding the data link layer, and we were currently having the discussion regarding the network layer. Now in the network layer there are four major types of protocols. One is IGMP, that is Internet Group Messaging Protocol, or you can say Internet Group Management Protocol. Second is ICMP, that is Internet Control Messaging Protocol. And then we have IP, and then we have ARP, that is Address Resolution Protocol. So IP is Internet Protocol. Now out of all these four protocols, one of the most important, or you can say the major protocol in the network layer, is the IP protocol, or you can say the IP protocol is the heart and soul of the network layer. And all the other protocols, for example, we have ICMP protocol and ARP protocol, they are meant to basically help the IP protocol. Even this ICMP protocol, which is showing us the error messages, so the main responsibility of ICMP protocol is about the error message. We'll see this ICMP protocol later on, because currently our discussion is related to the IP. So ICMP protocol is helping IP protocol to perform its operation. So the most important protocol that you can encounter in the network layer is the IP protocol. And the transport layer, we have the important protocols like SCTP, TCP and UDP. So currently this discussion is regarding the IP protocol. So we'll take the IP protocol and we'll see all the details regarding the IP protocols one by one. Now the first one is that IP protocol is an unreliable datagram protocol, and it is a best effort delivery service. Why we say that IP4 is an unreliable protocol? See, as you can see here, the IP protocol that we are discussing here, so we are currently studying the IPv4 protocol, that is Internet Protocol version 4. A part of this, we also have IPv6 protocol in the syllabus now. So just few years back, around I think 2-3 years back, IPv6 protocol was introduced, and IPv4 protocol was there from the last 10-15-20 years. From IPv4 protocol, they directly jumped to the IPv6 protocol. They skipped the IPv5 protocol because IPv5 protocol could not fulfill the requirement of so vastly growing internet, because our internet and the network is growing so fast that we feel that IPv5 protocol cannot keep up for the next 10 years. So that is why we try to introduce a protocol which should be reliable for the next 50 to 100 years. So they introduced the IPv6 protocol, that is Internet Protocol version 6, and they feel that IPv6 protocol will be enough for the next 50 years of the operation. As you can see, internet has grown tremendously in last 10 to 15 years. So tremendous growth we have seen. So that is why as it is growing exponentially, so we have to grow the protocol, we have to grow all the protocols and the rules that we are using tremendously according to cope up with the fast paced growing internet. So that is why IPv5 protocol was neglected. So after IPv4, directly IPv6 protocol we have introduced. So currently here we are studying the IPv6 protocol, sorry, IPv4 protocol. We are currently studying the IPv4 protocol, and we'll start with the header format of this IPv4 protocol, that is Internet Protocol version 4. Now the first thing that you can encounter here is that IPv4 protocol is an unreliable protocol. Why do we call it as unreliable? Because it is basically best effort delivery service. Now you see that we have a TCP protocol which works in the transport layer. TCP protocol works in the transport layer, and this IP protocol works in the network layer. Now this TCP protocol which works in transport layer, this is a connection oriented protocol. It is a connection oriented protocol, but this IP protocol is a connectionless protocol. It is a connectionless protocol. So we already had, I think we already had a discussion regarding connection oriented and connectionless also. But just for a recap, now this TCP protocol, when the first packet of this TCP protocol will go through the network, it will reserve some bandwidth, some path for the upcoming packet so that they can also follow the same path. But in case of IP protocol, because it is a connectionless protocol, so whenever you are transmitting data or you are transferring data from sender to the receiver, now these data packets can follow different paths throughout the network. That is why we call it as a connectionless protocol. And secondly, we call it as best effort delivery service. What exactly is the best effort delivery service? That it says that we will try our best to deliver the packet. But sometimes if we failed to deliver the packet, then we cannot guarantee its success. So we'll try our best to deliver the packet. It might happen that sometimes the packet will get discarded, sometimes the packet will get lost throughout the network. So if you see, the term best effort means the IPv4 protocol packets can be corrupted, be lost, or arrive out of order or be delayed. So why they will arrive out of order? Because IP protocol is a connectionless protocol. So if you see, if this is the sender and this is the receiver, so between this sender and the receiver, there might be multiple paths, there might be multiple networks that are present. So every packet can follow different path here, okay, before getting to the receiver. So it might happen that some packet are going through this path. It might happen that some packet here are following this path. So these packets can follow different paths. And obviously, because these packets can follow different path, and every packet is having uneven delay, some paths are having more delay, some paths are having less delay. So it may happen that when all the packets will reach to the receiver, these packets will be out of order. Out of order means out of sequence. Now this might be due to congestion of the network. Now if you want to ensure reliability in IP protocol, then you have to combine this IP protocol with other protocols. For example, we have TCP protocol, so that we can achieve reliability in IP. Okay. Now this is just an example of best effort delivery service, and I feel you all feel amused when I say the name of Indian Postal Service. So right now, these days, the service has improved a lot. Drastically, the service has improved. But earlier, what used to happen in 1970s, 80s and 90s. So whenever you try to send some letter to a person on the other hand, so sometimes they will try to deliver the message. They will try to deliver the letter, but sometimes the letter is not at all delivered. So at that point, when the letter was not delivered, so they do not inform the sender that it has delivered, as well as they do not inform the receiver that someone tried to send you a message. So that is a best effort delivery service. Just read out here. So post office does its best to deliver the regular mail, but it does not always succeed. So if an unregistered letter is lost or damaged, it is up to the sender or would be recipient to discover this. So it is the responsibility of the sender or the receiver to discover that the message that was sent is not delivered, is delivered or not. So the post office itself does not keep track of every letter and cannot notify a sender of loss or damage of a letter. So this is just an example of best effort delivery service. So we have already seen in the past that sometimes the letter is getting delivered after 10 years or 15 years or 20 years in Indian Postal Service. So we cannot guarantee when the letter is going to be is lost or not. So it happened in the past. So it just take it as a on a joke purpose. Now we have seen that this IPv4 is a connectionless protocol that uses the datagram approach. Now what exactly is a datagram approach? Datagram approach means you are going to divide the packets into datagram. Let me show you with an example. Okay. So there are various messages or packets that are present in the different layers of IP. So what happens is, if there's some user is there and user is tried to generate some message. So user was working on some kind of applications, maybe it is WhatsApp, maybe it is web browser or any kind of application. Maybe let us say the user is using WhatsApp. Okay. So user tried to enter some data. You try to send some message to your girlfriend, maybe boyfriend, or maybe someone in your family or someone. I mean, you just try to send some message. Okay. As soon as you created the message, that message will go through the application layer to the transport layer. Now in the transport layer, we have a protocol that is called as a TCP protocol. Now this TCP protocol in the transport layer, it will add its own, so when this data will go to the application layer, now this application layer will add its own header. So application layer takes the data from the user. For example, you are sending a message through a WhatsApp. Now WhatsApp is going to encrypt your message, and at the same time, when you are going to send the message, it is going to contain some information regarding the message. For example, when the message was created. Now for example, I just write, while creating this video, I just take my phone, I just send a message and press send message button. In that case, let us say I send the message as 3 p.m. 46th minute 56th second or something. So this is some kind of information regarding that packet, some kind of information regarding that message. So the message should be delivered instantly. In the same way, we can have different kinds of messages, different kinds of applications that may be having different kinds of requirement. The application can be your web browser where you are trying to browse the internet. The application can be your mail client where you are trying to send a simple email to your friend, that is SMTP. The application may be your instant messaging service. For example, WhatsApp is an instant messaging service. In the same way, there are different kinds of applications which may be having different kinds of headers. So when the user gives the data to the application, now this application adds its own header to the message, and then it delivers this entire message to the transport layer. Now what does this transport layer do is, in transport layer we use a protocol that is called as TCP. Now this, in the transport layer, the TCP protocol adds its own header to the message or the data that it got from the application layer. So in the application layer, we had a user data plus we added a header. Now this user data and header we placed here, and with that we added a TCP header. And when this is given to the network layer, I mean this entire TCP segment, when this TCP segment is given to the network layer, in the network layer we add the IP header with it, IP header. Now what does this header means? Actually this header contains additional informations. For example, in case of IP, the header will contain from where the message has arrived, to whom you are sending the message, which protocol are you using, what is the total length of the message, what is the length of the header, what is some kind of information regarding the network also. For example, do you want to fragment this entire packet or not? There are some different kinds of information that you are going to store in the message, in the header. So in a broad sense, header mostly acts as a metadata regarding the data that you want to send. So whatever the data you want to send, this header acts as a metadata. It contains information regarding the payload that it is currently having. Now you can see here in this layer, this network layer is going to add its own header, because we are using an IP protocol here, therefore the network layer is going to add as IP header. In the same way, we had something called as a TCP header. So TCP, this transport layer edits TCP header, and then we have the application data that we got from the application layer. So we also had application header. And when we'll give this message to the data link layer, further the data link layer is going to divide the message, divide the entire packet in terms of something called as frames, and the size of the frame will be dependent on your MTU, that is called as a maximal transmittable unit, maximum transmission unit, or maximum transferable unit. So there are different names. I'll cover all of them one by one. So when the message will get to the data link layer, the data link layer will divide the message into something called as a frame. So this is the frame. So every frame will be having a frame header, and it will be having a frame trailer. So in the end here, you can see this is the entire packet that we got. in this entire packet, every layer added some different kinds of information. For example, this data link layer added its header. So data link layer header, then the transport this network layer added the IP header, then transport layer added the TCP header, and then this application layer added its application header, and then you have the message which is your payload. And after this we'll be having a trailer from this data link layer. So you can see, just to send a very small message, just to send a single message, what is the different kind of information we have to add. So we have to add so many different information just to send a single message from the sender to the receiver. This is what happens when you send a message here. Now we are discussing about this IP header. I mean, what are all the information that this IP header is currently containing. Now let us look at all these informations one by one. So the packets that is used by the IP are called as datagrams, and this datagram is a variable length packet consisting of two parts. One is a header and the payload, and the header can be of 20 bytes to 60 bytes in length, and it contains the essential information regarding the route and the delivery of the message. We'll see what are those essential information. Now look at this diagram. Now in this diagram we have represented the entire datagram. This is representing an entire datagram, okay, and we are looking at this IP header. Now you see, before this IP headers, this data is actually containing various parts. It is containing the message, it is containing the TCP header, it is containing even the application layer header, and it is this is the information that this data is having, but still we are only interested in studying the IP header here. Now in the IP header we have the various fields means, what is the various kind of information this IP header is having. The first field is the version, second is the header length, then we have DS field. Actually this DS field is a very this field changed a lot in the past time. Earlier this field was known as a type of service field which also defined the priority. I think I've already created a video on the DS field, so I'll attach that video this folder. And then we have a total length field, we have identification field, we have some flags, we have fragment offset, we have time to live field, we have protocol, we have header checksum, we have source IP, destination IP, and some options. But let us just look at these fields one by one. Now when we get an IP datagram, in that IP datagram this header length is not variable. The minimum length of this header can be 20 bytes and the maximum length of this header can be of 60 bytes. That is totally dependent on the information that it is having. Now you see this diagram here, this diagram is representing your IP header. It is representing your IP header. Now in this IP headers we have various fields. For example, the very first field here is a version field. Now version field demonstrates or denotes which version is it. For example, here because we are studying IPv4 header, so here in this version field by default we are storing the version as 4. Therefore, because it is a 4-bit field, so this version field is going to store 0100, that is version in binary. Then we have this header length field. Now this header length field tells what is the length of this entire header, what is the total length of this entire header. Now why do we actually need this header length field? We need it because the length of the header is not fixed. So you can see the minimum length of the header can be 20, it can be 60, it can also be 32 bytes, it can also be 40 bytes, it can also be, the length can vary. There can be different kinds of length of this header. So because the header length field, the length of the header is not fixed, that is why to keep track of this we needed a specific field which is the header length field. It is a mandatory field. It should be there. It should be there because we don't know what is the total length of the header. Next is a service type field, and now this service type field is now called as a DS field. It has updated a lot. Earlier we used to call it a service type field. Now the name has changed. the various information that we used to store in this field, that has changed. So I'm going to add a video here which will completely demonstrate what is the service type field. And then we have the total length field. Actually, this total length field is going to store the total length of this complete datagram, including the header. Now, this total length field contains the total length of this IP datagram. Then we have identification field. We have flags. We have basically three flags here. One is reserved. Second is do not fragment, that is D field. It is also called as DF field. And second is the third flag is more fragment, that is MF field. So this is actually three bits which we store here. And then we have something called as fragment offset field, and then time to leave, protocol, header checksum, IP destination, and so on. Now for your examination, you have to remember the size of each and every field. This entire diagram you should be able to memorize. You should be able to recall this entire diagram in your examination hall. So I feel that if you practice, or better is if you just try to understand what every field means, then I think you will be able to remember this entire diagram. Now why the size of this is variable is, you see every row here, the first row is representing the version field is 4 bits. Then we have the header length field which is also 4 bits. Then we have service type field which is of 8 bits. Then we have total length field which is of 16 bits. So if you add all of them, it is going to be 32 bits. So in every row, you are going to store 4 bytes of data. So these rows, these are important and mandatory. So in the first row, you are storing 32 bits. Here also you are storing 32 bits. Here also you are using 32 bits. And here also you are using 32 bits of source IP. And you are using 32 bit of destination IP. So these 20 bytes of information should be there in the header at all times. These 20 bytes are actually mandatory. These 20 bytes are necessary. Then we have the rest 40 bytes here. These 40 bytes are optional. So this field is also called as options, and we also add some padding bits here in this 40 bytes. The length of this entire IP protocol here, it can be 20 bytes plus these 40 bytes. In these 45 bytes, we store various kinds of information. We can store some IP addresses. We can store different kinds of information. So sometimes we might use all the 40 bytes. Sometimes we might not use. Maybe we might use only 12 bytes. We might use only 20 bytes. So that is why the length of the IP headers is not fixed. It can be variable. It can vary. Okay. Now, let us discuss about each and everything field one by one. The first field here is the version field. Okay. Now look at the version field. So version field field stores the number which is showing the version of the IP protocol. So because we are studying IPv4 protocol, so version field is also going to store number as 4. This and IPv6 header is completely different than IPv4 header. They are two different kinds of headers. They store different kinds of information because they have updated it. Okay. Now, do one thing. Make this entire header in your notebook. Try to make a diagram for this entire header. And when I'm going to discuss with every field, just refer to your notebook. Refer to that page where you have drawn this header, and I'm going to take each and every field one by one. So the first field here is version. So version is 0100. So it stores these 4 bits of information, which says that the version is 4. If you convert this binary number to 4 to decimal, then it will say the version is 4. Now, the next is a header length field, which is a 4-bit field. Now, what is the minimum number that you can store with a 4 bit? So minimum number can be, so in header length field, it is a 4-bit field. Now with this 4 bit, the minimum number can be 0000 and maximum number can be 1111, which is equal to 15. So it is only storing number between 0 to 15, but you see that length of this entire header can be between 20 to 60 bytes. So we cannot represent this entire header length with this header length field. Therefore, we have to make this header length field as scalable, or you can say multipliable. So we use this header length field as a multiple of 4. Now, for example, if I say in this header length field, I have stored a number which is 1000. In the header length field, I have stored a number which is 1000. It means if you convert this number to decimal, it will give you a number which is 8. Multiply this 8 by 4, that is going to give you 32. So we say that entire length of the header is 32 byte. So whatever the number is stored in the header length field, multiply that number by 4. That will tell you the length of the entire header. Here the length of the entire header, if the number stored is 8, so the length of the entire header is going to be 8 multiplied by 4, which is 32. Now let us say here in this header length field I have stored a number which is 0010. If you see this 0010, convert this number from binary to decimal, you see that this number is 2. Then multiply 2 by 4, that is going to be 8. So it means the length of the header is 8 bytes, but you see the minimum length of the header is 20 bytes, therefore this number is not at all possible. Therefore, the minimum length that you are going to store, the minimum number that you are going to store in the header length field, that should demonstrate 20 bytes. So in this header length field, the minimum value, that you are going to store, that is going to be 10101, which is in decimal 5. So if you multiply 5 by 4, that is going to be how much? 20. So it is showing that size of the header is 20 bytes. Now if the header length field is storing the number 1111, which is representing a number 15, therefore multiply 15 by 4, which gives a number 60, therefore the size of this entire header is now 60 bytes. So this header length field is actually demonstrating the header of the length of this entire header. Now sometimes if something like this happens, that the length of the header is not a multiple of 4. For example, here let us say we used all these 20 bytes of information, 20 bytes here because these are mandatory. Then in the options field, I have stored only 2 bytes of information. Therefore the total length of this header is 22 bytes. But you can see here in the header length field, because it is a multiple of 4, therefore because it is a multiple of 4, so it should always get a number which is multiple of 4. Now this 22 is not a multiple of 4. When the length of the header is not a multiple of 4, in that case I am going to add some extra bits here, which is called as a padding, or you can say the padding bits. So we are going to pad or add some dummy bits to make the length of the entire header as a multiple of 4. This is what the header length field is. Okay. So just let us just look at some information regarding the header length field. So the header length field defines the total length of the datagram header in 4 byte words. That is why this is the multiple of 4. So receiver needs to multiply the value of this field by 4 to find the total length of header. This is how we use the header length field. So we know what is a version field. We know what is a header length field. For service type field, I have created a separate video for this. Just go and watch that video. I mean, after this, right now you don't need to study, within this video you don't need to study the service type field, but after this video I added one more video. I have recorded that video earlier, so where I have specified the service type field. So right now here we are going to discuss the field which is the total length field. Now what exactly this total length field? So total length field is going to give you the length of this entire IP datagram. So this total length field is of 16 bit, therefore the minimum number that you can demonstrate with 16 bits is all 16 zeros. All 16 zeros. which is a minimum number of 0, and the maximum number will be all 16 ones, which is 1111, 1111, 1111, and 1111, which is demonstrating a number which is 2 raised to power 16 minus 1. Therefore, this total length field can store the maximum number, which is 65,535. But you see, the minimum length of the header is going to be 20 bytes. So this total length field is also going to store a minimum of number which is 20 and the maximum the number which is 65,535. And this total length field demonstrates the total length of packet with one byte, I mean with every byte. For example, if I say the length of the entire packet is 4000 bytes. So in the total length field, we will store a binary number which is representing a decimal number which is 4000. So for every byte, we will store a number. For every byte, we will store a number. So total length field demonstrates the total length of this packet. Okay. So if you know the total length of the packet and you want to find out the length of the payload, then it will be total length minus header length. Total length minus header length. So if you want to find the length of payload, it is going to be total length minus whatever the information that is stored here in header length in decimal, multiplied that information by 4. So you'll get the payload length. Just look at this formula here. So length of the data packet is the total length field minus header length field multiplied by 4. So we'll get the length of the data packet. That is the total length field. So the question is, why do we actually need the total length field? So in every case, every time we don't require the total length field, only in some specific cases we are going to require this total length field. So there are occasions in which datagram is not only the thing encapsulated in the frame, it will also be padding that has to be added. Now for example here, as I told you in the previous case, that sometimes this information is 20 bytes, and in the options field you are storing 2 bytes of information, so total you are going to have 22 bytes, but you have to store some extra information, some extra padding bits. You can store some padding bits here as well as here. For the payload also you are going to store some padding bits. The reason is, in for example Ethernet, the minimum length of the packet that you can send, that minimum length is also fixed and the maximum length is also fixed. In Ethernet means LAN. In LAN, the maximum length that we found out according to experimenting, we find out that maximum length that you can send is 1500 bytes for a data packet, that is also called as MTU, and minimum that length that you should send is 46 bytes. So sometimes if the message is less than 46 bytes, for example, let us say you started WhatsApp. In WhatsApp, you just written hi. So you are going to send this hi to the receiver. Now with this hi is just two characters. For two characters, maybe you can represent two characters by 2 bytes, or maybe you can represent the two characters by 4 bytes. 2 bytes in ASCII and 4 bytes in Unicode. Okay, so you can just represent this 4 byte of information with this 4 bytes of to this high information with just 4 bytes of character. Or sometimes nowadays, whenever you have to write OK, for OK we have a shortcut which is just write K, when you send K to your friend on WhatsApp. So that is a very small information. So because it is a very very small information, that is why we have to add some extra information with this. We have to pad some extra bit with this so that we can send this message through your LAN also through the network. So that is why sometimes you have to add some extra information with the data packet, and that is called as padding. So if the size of the IP4 datagram is less than 46 bytes, then some padding will be added to meet this requirement. Now in this case, when a machine decapsulates the datagram, it needs to check the total length field to determine how much really is the data and how much is the padding, that is how much is the extra information that you have added and how much really is the data that you wanted to send. That is why we need the total length field, and obviously it is an important field. Okay, now we have seen the virgin field, we have seen the header length field, and we have seen the total length field. Actually, we are going to discuss these fields in more detail in upcoming videos. I'm just discussing a brief idea with you, brief introduction about all these fields one by one. So the next row here is representing your identification, flags, and fragment offset. Now this second row is basically, it is create for fragmentation. It is creating, we have created this field for fragmentation. This field actually very, very important and very interesting also. There's some numericals that I can include in this field to make it interesting. So we have three things. One is identification, second is flag, and third is fragment offset. Now what exactly this identification? Identification means whenever a datagram, you are going to get a datagram from the network layer, for with that datagram I am going to add some identification information, just like an ID number. Okay, let me just explain it to you with the help of an example. Okay, this is the sender, this is the receiver, and sender is sending network data through this network. And these are representing frames, or you can say these are representing fragments. Actually, these fragments, these frames, this fragmentation is done here at the data link layer. Okay, let me show you why and how. See, this is representing, I think if this diagram is not visible, just take out a PDF from the website www.digimentor.com. From there you can see this diagram clearly. I feel that sometimes this diagram might not be visible while you are watching the video in low resolution. Try to see if you can watch the video in high resolution, this diagram will be visible. But understand, we have the first three layers are application, presentation, and session. So in the application, presentation, session, a message is created. Now you give this message to the transport layer. In this transport layer, so transport layer is going to add its header and it is going to add its message. Okay. Then this message is given to the network layer. Network layer is going to take the packet, this entire packet from the transport layer. It is going to put this packet here. It will be called as payload, and it will add its own header. So we are currently this studying this header. Now the interesting part comes exactly here. So this entire packet, sometimes it can become large, huge, according to the requirement. For example, sometimes a user want to send 4 GBs of file to the friend, or you want to upload some video on YouTube. So the file size will be bigger. Now because the file size is bigger, therefore this message size will also get bigger. This message size will also increase. So message size is variable, remember. Message size is variable. It can be a very small message, it can be a very large message. Small message like just sending hi on WhatsApp. Very large message means you are uploading a big video file on YouTube. You are uploading a big files on Google Drive or YouTube. So message size can also be large, it can also be small. So this entire packet at the network layer, this entire packet can become huge or it can become large. But your network, for example, you are using an Ethernet. Now Ethernet network might not be able to hold this entire packet, because of the limitation of the hardware that you are using on your routers or on your host or on your network, or the limitations that is imposed by the software. So limitation might be imposed by the software, it might be imposed by the hardware. But generally in Ethernet, as I told you, in Ethernet the size of a packet or the size of a frame can be maximum of 1500 byte. So what I'm going to do is, if let us say this is of 4000 bytes, then I have to divide this packet into smaller frames. So I'm going to divide this packet in smaller frames, and these, the size of this frame will be dependent on MTU, that is called as maximum transmissible unit, or maximum transmittable unit, or maximum transferable unit. There are multiple names for MTU, all mean the same: transmittable, transferable, transmissionable, or transmission. Okay, what is the maximum size of the frame that you can send through the network, that is called as MTU. That's it. So I'm going to take this packet from the network layer and I'm going to divide this packet onto smaller frames in the data link layer. And with every frame, I'm going to add some extra information. If you zoom in one frame, you'll see there's a header, there's a message, then there's a trailer. So there are three information in every frame. For example, frame number one, frame number two, frame number three, these three informations are there. Okay. Then you are going to send this entire message through your transmission media. Or let us say this first router that has encountered. Now, in every router, understand this clearly, in every router we are having at least three layers. Why I'm saying at least? Because some routers might be able to and might be having transport layer also, but in every router we are having three layers, that is physical, data link and network. Okay, so this router will take the packet from the physical layer, it will read the packet from the data link layer, every router will read the packet, it will process the packet, it will store the packet, and then it will forward the packet by modifying the information. As I told you, there are three kinds of things. I told this to you multiple times. I told you that we have port to port connectivity, we have host to host connectivity, and we have hop to hop connectivity. So this data link layer deals with hop to hop connectivity. I mean, it deals with sending the data from one hop to another hop. And what are the hops here? So this host to this first router is one hop. From this router to the next router is another hop. From this router to the next router is another hop. So it only deals with the hop to hop connectivity, because in this data link layer, we also take the machine address, or you can say MAC address. With the help of, in network layer, we take IP address, IP logical address of every host. But in data link layer, it deals with the machine address, MAC address. So this frame will then be given to this router. This router is going to take this frame. It will read, it will discard its previous header and trailer. It will discard the previous information. It decapsulated. So whenever you are going from up down here, then you are, that means you are encapsulating the packet, and whenever we are going from bottom to up, that means we are decapsulating the packet. So here in this data link layer, we are going to decapsulate the packet. We are going to remove the header and the trailer of the data link layer, and then we will give this packet to the network layer. Now in the network layer on this router, you can see in the network layer on the on every router, the network layer is going to read the IP address, because every router is going to maintain a routing table, and that routing table contains the information regarding the IP address and the corresponding interface, through which path you have to follow. For example, if this is a router, so there are multiple paths after this router here, and there's a message which is coming to this. So it is interface 0, interface 1, interface 2. So whenever a message, this router will receive a message, it will read the IP address to which it has to forward the message. And for that IP address, it is going to read through which interface it has to forward the packet again. For that, it is mandatory, it is important for the router to read the packet till the network layer. So router will read the packet till the network layer, and after reading the packet till network layer, it will get the IP address information, and then it will decide to which interface I have to forward the packet, to which path I have to forward the packet, to which path I have to forward the packet. So to forward the packet again, it will start encapsulating the packet. It will start encapsulating the packet from the network layer onwards. So every router is going to read the data till network layer. Then it will change the header of the network layer. It will change the header of the data link layer. And then it will again forward the packet through the interface to the next router. Again, the next router is going to read the data till network layer, and then it will again encapsulate it with the new header for network layer, for data link layer, and again it will forward the packet to a certain kind of interface. And finally, the receiver will receive the packet. This is your entire process. Okay. So this process is interesting, but I have to show how this IP address, what are the values of this IP address, how this the values of this IP address changes with each of these routers. We need to understand this information, how this values of this IP address is getting changed. Okay. Let us take these informations one by one. So, first of all, you need to understand what is the maximum transfer unit, or maximum, sometimes it is also called as transmittable unit. I call this word many times here, or transmission unit, maximum transmission unit or so. So, this is a maximum size of the frame that you can send through the data link layer. So each data link layer protocol has its own frame format. One feature of each format is a maximum size of payload that can be encapsulated. In other words, when the datagram is encapsulated in a frame, the total size of datagram must be less than the maximum size. So this is your IP datagram that is you got from the IP layer. This is the payload that you got from transport layer. You give this to a frame, and it becomes a frame payload. So this data link layer add its own header, it add its own trailer, and it put the frame here in this payload. So what happens when I say the total MTU is 1500 bytes? So let us say, if I say the MTU of a network is 1500 bytes. Through internet, you can only transfer a maximum frame size of 1500. And what is this frame? This is that frame that you can only transmit a maximum frame size of 1500. So with that 1500, in TCP layer, we are going to have something called as MSS, that is maximum segment size. I'm going to discuss the maximum segment size when I'm going to take the TCP layer. Then in IP layer and in Ethernet layer, we talks about the MTU, that is maximal transmittable unit. Now in this maximum transmittable unit, you have a payload. You have the TCP header, you have the IP header. So this packet is then, if the total size of this packet, you can see the maximum payload that we can have here is 1460 bytes. If the Ethernet size, if in case of Ethernet, the MTU is 1500, so the total size of the payload can be 1460 bytes, that is 1460 bytes, plus we are going to add 20 bytes of header for transport layer. Plus, we are going to add 20 bytes of header from network layer. So total size becomes 1500 bytes. If I say the MTU is 1500 bytes, that means that the maximum packet size that you can send in one frame that you got from network layer is 1500. I'll take this example again, but again, you see, then we add an Ethernet header which is of 14 bytes and Ethernet trailer which is of 4 bytes. So if I say the MTU is 1500 bytes, that means I'm going to transfer 1520 bytes of one frame size. So frame size can be of 1520 bytes. Okay. So if in any network, if I say through this network the MTU is 1500, and we are getting a message from network layer which is, let us say, 4000 bytes. Okay. Now we are going to divide this message into smaller messages, and the size of every message here will be less than 1500, less than or equal to 1500, and then we'll add a header on this, and we'll add a trailer on this message, and then we'll make it as a frame. So In every frame, if MTU is 1500, so in every frame, we have the payload of 1500 bytes, we'll be having a header of data link layer, we'll be having a trailer of data link layer, so which may be 1520 bytes or something. I mean, so empty is 1500, so that means payload is of 1500 maximum that you can transfer. Okay. Now let us see what are the different values or how this fragmentation is done through this network. Okay. I think the video will become long, so I'll make a second part of this video where I'm going to explain every process of fragmentation one by one. Okay.